Thank you very much. It's great to be here. So this is kind of a utopia here in Indiana. You disabled and non-disabled sort of hang together all the time like this. Is that right? It's nice to be in the state. 12 electoral votes for, who was it, George Bush? Is that right, here in Indiana? So how many of you are worried about Clinton? Worried about the new president? Anyone worried? All right, I'm here really to tell you not to worry, not because I have anything to do with Clinton, not because I'm not worried about Clinton, but because I think that this election is very important. And since I just got back from Somalia, and I need some air in my tires, and there's a new president, I decided I would link the fact that I don't have enough air in my tires with the disaster in Somalia and the fact that we have a new president together in a sort of a loose set of remarks that I would like to entitle, "The Taboo Has Lifted." What's the taboo? Well, the taboo has nothing to do with Jennifer Flowers. It has nothing to do with the kinds of character issues that were discussed by George Bush and Bill Clinton during the campaign. The taboo, I think, has to do with advocacy. The taboo has to do with, when are we participants and when are we activists? And I think this election was not really about Bill Clinton. It was not really about George Bush. It was about language and it was about advocacy. And people decided that they were sick and tired of voting as an act of endorsing someone's resume. And I have, you know, nothing particular against George Bush. But what I would say is that for the last 12 years, we have viewed the presidency and viewed our political institutions in the United States as a kind of an opportunity for us to discuss, well, you know, he's presidential. Now, he over here, he's not presidential. And while that's a very natural thing for us to do, because in our environment, in our professional environment, we're constantly going, you know, this guy I would like to have fly the plane that I'm in. Now, this guy over here, maybe I don't want him flying the plane that I'm in. And these issues of competence and who is appropriate for the job turns almost everything in politics in America into a kind of a job interview, where the president sort of comes to you and sits down and you kind of say, well, what experience have you had? And George goes, started that Gulf War. Did, you know, brought the world together. You know, Saddam Hussein, we defeated him. And I can't do a Clinton imitation. Actually, a Clinton imitation is something like this. With a couple of croaks in there. That's sort of a Clinton interview. We'll probably be hearing a lot more of that over the next 4 years. And so instead of a job interview kind of a relationship that we will have with our political leaders in the next 4 years, and I think really between now and much more into the next century, our relationship will become one of, we vote not to check off somebody's resume and say, sure, give them the job. We vote because we are participants in change. We vote because suddenly our activism is important. What we think is important. The kinds of decisions we make are important, and how we come to those decisions is something we actually have to do actively. It's not something we just sort of sit there and go, you know, Perot has big ears. And that's a political statement. It's not a political statement. And indeed, I think what this election was about was going from a passive mode, a passive sense of, well, if I just allow the rich people to be really, really happy in America, some of that money is going to come down to me. Now, let's put aside the economics of that for a moment. I mean, there are a lot of people that can argue about whether trickle-down economics and the kinds of free market assumptions about the economy were a great idea or if they were, you know, hopelessly misguided. We have to all agree that from the get-go, it's a passive notion. It's not a notion of going out and it's not a Franklin Roosevelt kind of notion. And again, I'm not being partisan here. It's not a notion of let's build some dams and let's change the course of America and we're all on the same team and we're all working together and we're all participants in change and if we mobilize all of our efforts, we're going to get somewhere. It's much more the system is fine, the system works, the system is not really about me, the system is sort of up there, we can hear it in the background kind of going and you know, maybe there are people there to oil it, but our assumption is that if we just make the system happy, that it's going to benefit us. Our connection is passive to the system. This is, I think, what has changed in 1992. And this is why Clinton is president and why Bush is not president. Because Clinton, for all of his problems and for all of his reminiscence, for all of his similarity, for my taste, to Richard Nixon and Lyndon Johnson, people who were sort of born with one thought in their mind, and that is to be president someday, You know, I don't know if that's, I don't know if that's a sign of some magnificent ambition or march down the corridors of time, or if it's some kind of mental illness that no one has managed to actually classify yet. But one can definitely say that Bill Clinton and the people around him and the way that that campaign was run appealed to this notion that, hey, it's okay. Not only is it okay, it's critical. Not only is it okay and critical, but here's how to do it for you to actually decide to change things, for your vote to be a part of that change, and for when you decide to vote, to figure that you are actually a participant in change. Now, what does that mean? That means that a whole set of assumptions about our society and about the way things work is suddenly called into question, which brings me to sort of the second point here. You've heard of this term objectivity in journalism, right? Balance, objectivity. I imagine, you know, here at the journalism school, they're trying to cram that stuff down your throat right about now. Is that right? Probably something like that. I'm here to say that while objectivity is a good sort of starting point for thinking about journalism and thinking about stories and thinking about the way it is some of you are going to go out and be reporters and be communicators, it's not an endpoint. It's not a model. It's not an ideal, because it's a passive notion. Objectivity is this set of assumptions. It says, okay, if I read enough reports, if I spend a long enough time in this room interviewing this senator, if I go to enough news conferences, that a story is going to kind of be born out of that, and I'll see it, and then I'll report it, and that will be the end. My decisions about what I think is meaningful, what I think is true, what I think is right and wrong, even, to get into the really radical part of the whole thing, is kind of irrelevant. It's kind of something I kind of want to stay away from, even. Let me tell you a story about objectivity in Somalia. And these are just the kinds of situations that you get in journalism. And I don't want to say that I get into these situations a lot, but I will tell you that this story is particularly on my mind. We land in, and Somalia is a place, I should say, where it's very difficult to be objective. Very difficult to think objectively about it. I mean, you can't go into a place like Somalia where people are really starving and dying all around you and climb into the blimp of journalism and sort of, you know, kind of go over the place and kind of look, oh, there's some famine over there. Let's stop down there and get a little picture. You really can't do that in a place like Somalia, because you're constantly addressing the reasons why you're a human being. What are you doing on the planet? Why are you sitting here? Why are you alive? Why are they dead? You know, these kinds of questions really come right to the fore. So the question of objectivity is instantly suspect in a place like Somalia. But we were at this airport, and if I don't know if you know anything about television crews and how they operate at the network level. I'm just learning myself, coming from 12 years of NPR, where the definition of a radio crew is a guy, a microphone. That's a radio crew. And, you know, hopefully some batteries, but then, you know, radio people are kind of slow sometimes. And maybe they forget their batteries. But in radio, you can always fake it. You know, you can just do the actuality yourself if you need to, and no one will know the difference. And that's no confession on my part, let me say. I always brought my batteries. All the interviews were legit. But in television, you travel with armies. You travel with zillions of people and 10,000 cables and cameras, and you don't just sort of, you know, hi, we're a TV crew. You know, we're just gonna sit here and quietly observe things. TV people come in and say, hello, hi, ABC News, hi, we're here. You starving people over here, okay? You're the government? Oh, great. Oh, I love that. Government. Oh, fabulous. You sit here, we'll interview you in a minute. All right, as soon as these people die over here, we'll interview you. That's the sort of sense of television's intervention into the scene. And there's not much objective about that. When you really get down to it, I mean, you know, television isn't objective. It's the whole game. It's the complete, total game. So notions of balance and objectivity are instantly suspect in television. But anyway, we're in Somalia. Somalia is a place that has no government. Let's just say that right off the top. Has no food, has no running water, has no electricity. Everything is blown to pieces from top to bottom. The only people with any kind of electricity or any kind of water or food are the NGOs, the so-called non-governmental organizations like the Red Cross, the International medical corps, the blue hats, those are the people from the UN who you're going to be hearing a lot about in the next century. That's another story for another time. There's sort of the global bureaucracy that's gradually going to take over all of our lives. They've already taken over Somalia. Other organizations, NGOs, and you go into their compounds and they have these generators and they run all night, and that's the only source of electricity. Out in the community, out in the country, it's dark. There's no infrastructure of any kind, and the only authority are, you know, 13 and 14 year old boys with grenade launchers, cruising around, basically deciding if you can go here, if you can go there. The vehicles you ride around in come with their own security detachment. Again, these aren't mall security guards. These aren't Mogadishu's finest. These are more 13 and 14-year-olds with grenade launchers and AK-47s and M16s and any other kind of weapon that managed to have been dropped off in Somalia courtesy of the superpowers over the last 20 to 25 years, which is kind of the story we were doing. But anyway, if you want to operate, now, if you're a radio guy, a guy with a microphone, you just sort of walk in and you kind of say, yeah, I'd like to just hitch a ride and go over here, and maybe they'll give you a seat. But if you want to actually use a vehicle and have something with ABC News written at the top of it, you have to hire a whole bunch of these security guys. So suddenly, you're supposedly objective in a country like Somalia, but what did you do as soon as you landed? Well, we hired our own army. A little army. It's just a small army, but we hired an army. I mean, consider. Here you are, a journalist trying to get the story. What's the first thing you do? Hire some guys with guns to take us around so that we can make sure that we get the story. You can't be objective in a situation like that, and no one who claims to be is telling you the truth. That's not to say that you don't know the story. That's not to say that you can't discover truth. But you have to give up some of your assumptions about journalism to operate in a place like this. Okay, so here we are, two Toyota Land Cruisers, zillions of guys with grenade launchers and things all over the Land Cruisers, and we're cruising around town. And because there's no gas stations in Somalia, no. The only way to get fuel is to basically go to the 25 and 26-year-old guys with grenade launchers who actually are in charge of the tank trucks filled with petroleum and diesel, gasoline. Been out of the country too long. Gasoline and diesel. And you basically make a deal with them, and you give them some money, and they fill a 55-gallon drum with gasoline or diesel. You put that in the back of your Land Cruiser, a 55-gallon drum filled with petroleum, surrounded by people with grenade launchers, pistols, chain-smoking all the time, and then you just sort of go your merry way, driving around Somalia, trying to do interviews and get stories. Mom wouldn't recommend that you drive around in your Land Cruiser chain smoking with a 55-gallon drum of gasoline in the back seat. And you know, some of these 55-gallon drums have some dents in them, and some of these 55-gallon drums have some rust on them. And yes, the smell of gasoline is very, very present all the time you're in these Land Cruisers. But that again, you know, so what does that mean? It means that you can actually exist in a situation like that, and human beings can actually exist in a situation like that. And when you begin to think about your own society versus a place like Mogadishu, you understand that, you know, society doesn't just vanish. Humanity doesn't just vanish because, you know, the lights go out at the 7-Eleven or somebody loses all the three-prong adapters, okay, and you can't plug in any VCRs, you know, for a month, you know. When stuff like that happens, society doesn't vanish. It begins to kind of ratchet down. It begins to sort of get on a downward trend. And in a passive mode, when you're thinking passively about your society and about journalism, about things, your inclination is to just kind of say, well, things are on a downward trend. And you better hope that you pull out of your passive mode before you get to a crucial point where things get really into the 13-year-old grenade launcher zone. Back to Somalia for a moment, and I'll come back to that thought before the end of the hour. Somalia is a story where people are barely alive next to people who are completely alive. It's kind of Dodge City next door to, you know, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, the extent to which some people, masses of people are dying directly next to people who are fine and who are transacting, and the inability to distinguish why these people are dying versus why these people are living is central to the story and is an indicator that the whole society and infrastructure of a place, the way that milk gets delivered, the way that rice gets delivered, this is the casualty of a Holocaust that took place there for a lot of political reasons, which is why we were there. But moving in that environment, you know, you can't observe the kind of big systemic things. You can't go into a place like Somalia and look for tribalism. Because these sorts of concepts, they're maybe relevant over here, but they're not relevant over here. And there's no tribalism in an entire town where 50% of the people are one day from death. There's no tribalism there. There's no family. People have lost their identity exclusively. One of the most striking things about being in Somalia was going into a village of children and seeing among 50 children, all of whom were profoundly malnourished, of a piece that you couldn't describe yourself ever coming back from that. Yet, one still discovered the gradations of survival, even at that low, low level. And I don't mean low in a pejorative sense. All of us have the capacity to experience what these people in Somalia are experiencing. But here in this crowd of children, you could separate from the children who had a couple of days, who still understood that if they could stagger over to the box of crackers and get a couple, that meant that they would go on. There were plenty of kids who understood, who were so certain of their imminent death. And these are children, mind you. These kids don't know. I mean, you know, they carry this look in their eyes, and you can see it. And the other children know them too. It's almost as though on the playground, you know, you've got the club-footed kid, right, to bring in the disability issue again, and all the other kids know that he's a little slow, you know. And there's this sort of social dynamic that exists. Kids understand what's going on. Kids understand these forces. But here it is being played out, the very exact same phenomenon. And it's a question of life and death. And here are the kids who know that they're dead next to the kids who think that they're probably still alive for a little while. And that is so far removed what we think of as the low threshold beyond which we can't possibly go. Well, you know, if they raise our taxes one more time, you know, that's it. It's terror in the streets. You know, we really have to think very hard about what it is that makes our society work and how connected we are to those forces, because human beings will live a long, long time after society ceases to function, and it's not very pretty. Anyway, we're driving these Land Cruisers with the grenade launchers and everything, and we do our story, and we go to these villages, and we see these kinds of things. And again, all of us, the producer, myself, cameraman, the sound men, are confronting our sense of objectivity, confronting the sense that, you know, these people are actually connected to us because all of the weapons are American. If they aren't American, they're Soviet. And the Soviets dumped weapons in there because they thought the weapons we were creating were meant for them, and so that if they could get some into Africa, maybe they could win some sort of battle. I mean, the Soviets were as complicit in this as the Americans, but nevertheless, one saw the Cold War. One saw in the Russians are our enemy being played out in this third world backwater nation. And you even ask, you go to a place called Berbera in North Somalia, where there's the second longest runway in Africa. And you ask people, you say, what was this for? What was this runway for? It was built by the United States. The base itself, the facilities, were built by the Soviets. And, you know, someone in the town goes, well, you know, we heard that the space shuttle was coming, that the space shuttle was going to land here, but it never came. And they understood what was going on. They understood that variously they were a kind of strategic backwash, that they were a part of the Cold War. But they also understand that what it left them with is a lot of grenade launchers. And, you know, elderly men who were village chieftains in places like Somalia aren't interested in grenade launchers. Who's interested in grenade launchers if you're not in the army? 13-year-old boys. So they have the grenade launchers. So we're back to the Land Cruisers driving around. We did our stories. We went to the airport in a place called Baidoa, which you probably saw a lot of pictures from over the last few months. And the problem in Somalia, where there's no government or no police or anything, is that every facility that exists in this country has a kind of security detachment associated with it. I told you each vehicle has its own little security guard group. Every petrol outpost, every tank farm, every tank truck has a security detachment associated with it. The Red Cross has its own police force. And every airport has its own local security, which is concerned some local warlord and a lot of his boys and a lot of weapons. And in a situation where everyone's kind of transacting this, I'm going to stand here. No, you're not. Oh, yes, I am. No, you're not. Yes, I am. But you have like AK-47s and grenade launchers. There's this kind of schoolyard language superimposed with this, nuclear holocaust level of armament. So you go to the airport, and here are guys we hired from Mogadishu. So they're like the big city boys with the grenade launchers. And in Baidoa, it's something of a kind of a Muncie, Indiana, if you know what I mean. And the people from Chicago, Mogadishu, they're happy to go to Muncie, but they're not going to really take a lot of guff from the people of Baidoa. And so, you see this tension all the time. You see this tension depending on what kind of football team is coming to play here, from the fans. But give everyone an AK-47, and this sort of tension, which is kind of page 6 in the local newspaper, becomes, you look at me wrong, you die. And that's what it becomes. And that's what Somalia is. So we're at the airport, and our sound man, great guy, really wonderful guy, almost got us killed. He decides that he's going to go with this Swedish relief guy. They're all over the world. These Swedish relief guys are about 9 feet tall. They've, been fed on apple pie since they were born. They have smiles on their faces. You can't do anything to get the smile off these people's faces. They walk around talking about, we're bringing the blood in, it's great. We're trying to help these people. They don't appear to have a clue of what's going on in the country. It's fine. I love them. They're fantastic. It's great that they're there. However, our sound man and this Swedish guy start walking over by this burnout fighter jet that's on the airport at Baidoa. Again, a piece of junk left over from the Cold War that has no chance of flying. It's of no strategic significance. But the greatest irony, perhaps, of the Cold War was that it was a point of honor of these boys at this airport that you can't go over there. It's a strategic site. It's a critical military installation, and we don't want you going over there. It's like military installation. Why don't we worry about the water?
First, what about that?
Or the food. It's a military installation. You can't go over there. Just stay away. And we were told that at the beginning, but for some reason the sound man doesn't get the message, and the Swedish guy thinks that it would make a great picture. Fabulous picture. So he goes over. He whips out his little, Japanese camera. Click, click. Immediately, the security guards at the Baidoa airport come like zipping in their Toyota pickups with their 50 caliber machine guns mounted on the back, and they're like,
"What is this? You cannot. It is against security. No."
Well, fine. So my producer is 6 months pregnant. I'm in a wheelchair. there's something wrong with that? So we're at the airport trying to like de-escalate this situation.
Meanwhile, who's protecting us?
The Mogadishu boys. And the Mogadishu boys, they've been paid $100 a day, and all the ammunition they can stomach, and all the food they can stomach, and all the petrol they can stomach. What's their job? What was the job we gave them?
If anyone, messes with us, I guess, we didn't tell them this, but if you hire boys to protect you in Land Cruisers, basically they understand their job description. It's anybody messes with you, they're dead. Dead. Okay.
So here we have all these vehicles out on the tarmac at Baidoa Airport. We're trying to calm down these security people. Look, he didn't really mean to take a picture of that whole thing. The Mogadishu boys go, "Are these dudes hassling you here? Are these dudes being a problem?" This 13-year-old runs over to the vehicle, grabs his grenade launcher, throws the grenade inside, and he just starts saying, "You even look at our sound man and you're dead." To which the Baidoa security, and not only are you dead, but you Baidoa wimp, scum, jerk off. It's that kind of language. It's totally this Baidoa redneck chump, what you think? It's like, no way. And this is what they're transacting, but of course they're all armed to the teeth. And
we're all in vehicles with 55-gallon drums filled with gas, you know, on an airport runway in the middle of nowhere. And it's like, there doesn't seem to be any problem with pulling a trigger. And one trigger, you know, the one thing that you expect to see in Somalia is like lots of skeletons and burned out vehicles where like people actually got into a fight, because there's no one that wins in these fights. It's like everyone opens up, that's it. Okay, kaboom, and that's the end, everyone's dead. So this seemed to be like it was going to happen. And the last straw was the security reinforcements from the airport come running out, and these are the boys with bazookas. And these six boys with bazookas come running out because there's a confrontation going on now, and apparently these things happen every couple of days, so it's like almost a ritual with them. And these boys come screaming out with their bazookas, and Leslie, the producer, and I are in the middle of these vehicles, and these boys get down on the ground and aim their six bazookas at our vehicles. And we're on the airport. I mean, we're waiting for an American Air Force C-130 transport to come and take us away, you know, and it doesn't. And we were just waiting at the airport, you know. We were just in the departure lounge, and all of a sudden, it's World War III. So the question is, I mean, obviously, if we'd all died, you know, it would have been just sort of a little story, you know, that would have made a footnote somewhere, and it really had nothing to do with Somalia, and had nothing to do with the famine, and had nothing to do with the relief effort, and it, you know, had something to do with television and what journalists do for a living. But in no case were we passive participants. In no way were we anything but part of the landscape. And so even though when we were arguing to try to get out of there, our assumption was, hey, we're journalists, hey, you know, let us go, we're just kidding, let's stop, no fighting. Clearly, we were a part of the conflict that was going on in Somalian society. We were on a side, whether we chose to acknowledge it or not. We were a part of the conflict. We were grist for the conflict. And in the ultimate sense, we were representatives of a world that had brought the weapons to this country, that had torn itself apart. At no point did we have the opportunity to say, hey, just kidding, just in it, really a TV show, really, you know, just, could you just kill yourselves, you know, and leave us out of it, you know? And expect anyone to understand that. And they're not going to understand that. Because in a world like we live in today, where resources are declining, where the space of the world is finite, and we can see it finite, it's often the case that one person's presence in a space means that another person isn't going to be there. And regardless of your sense that, hey, I'm just here, the fact that the other person is like not there, that looks to them like an activist thing. That looks like, hey, you pushed me out. You know, that's an act. That's an activist thing. You know, and I said, no, I'm just here. You know, I have a right to be here. Well, in the 21st century, rights are a function of space, are a function of consensus, are a function of everyone figuring out what it is we all want, rather than a couple of people figuring out what they want. And if I get mine, you know, you can have some of yours. And calling that freedom. And when you're in modes that are objective, when you're in modes that are passive, when you think of your vote as a kind of a, you know, I think Bush is the winner here, you know, and I think Clinton is the loser guy. You're not using your vote for change. You're not thinking about your political act as a function of change, as a you're not thinking the big thought, which is, what society do I want? Okay, so Bill Clinton can't deliver it to me in a package. I have to be a part of the delivery. Okay, fine, but at least my vote is going to represent in a small way an answer to the question, what kind of society do I want? In Somalia, people never had the opportunity to ask that question because they were never able to vote. And the forces that were brought to bear by the Cold War, the weapons and the decline and the the economic depravity, allowed that situation to decline to a point beyond which society could function. And those people now are faced with trying somehow to reconstruct their society. They have no passive option whatsoever. They have to reconstruct the baker, the butcher, the candlestick maker, the money changer. Everything has to be built from the ground up. Somalia is a glimpse of the future. If we maintain our own passive modes of political discourse,
of journalism, for instance, and even of disability. If we think that disabled people are going to be empowered, or anyone, blacks, anyone in this country, poor, are going to be empowered simply by, well, hey, you know, come to my house, and I'll, like, talk to you, and you'll be my friend, and then after a while, you'll have more friends, and then later on, maybe someone will give you a job, and if you work really hard and keep that smile on your face, you know, you'll get a job as a dispatcher, you know, at a firehouse, and that'll be great. Whereas the only thing that's really going to empower African Americans, for instance, is confrontation, is saying, look, I don't want to destroy you, but at least I understand enough about our society and the way it operates that for me to get what I want requires you to accept that you can't have everything. There's a conflict there. We have the means in our society to work out these questions, to actually say, okay, what kind of society do we want? How are we going to be together? Not defining society as this race where, hey, I'm the winner, I'm white, I'm the winner, gee, isn't that funny? You know, and then suddenly all the blacks who complain about that are like, you're just, you know, you can't carp about the rules now. Democracy is about carping about the rules. Democracy and freedom is about systems and processes that are all about carping about the rules, all about stopping the race in the middle and saying, wait a minute, we should do this a little differently. All about changing in the middle of the game. It's not about winners and losers. And the extent to which I, as a disabled person, decided that, you know, in the beginning, well, you know, if I'm strong and I work hard and I do all my push-ups and keep air in my tires, jeez, look at this, it's disgusting, that I too will have an opportunity to have a job, a good job, and to be a participant in our society. When what I've discovered is, no, if I want freedom, if I want equality, it's my responsibility to demand it. It's my responsibility to demand it persuasively. You know, I mean, I'm okay, there are days when I want the grenade launcher like the guy in Somalia. Okay, fine. But most of the time, at the very least, I have to confront those who would deny or pretend that it's not important that I have what it is I need to do the kinds of things that I want. I can't expect to get everything I want, but I can never expect to get anything unless I am an active participant in my own future. Sometimes that involves confrontation. This movie Malcolm X that's coming out, sure, Spike Lee wants money. Sure, Malcolm X is a commodity that's gonna end up on people's foreheads and on people's bumper stickers. Sure, but Malcolm X is about the phenomenon of confrontation, of taking responsibility for your own future, of answering the question, what kind of society do I want? At the time that he did it, that was not a terribly important skill to have. Indeed, that was an important skill to have if you wanted to go to the federal pen or get assassinated as he did. I contend that the skills of a Malcolm X are more a part of the 21st century than the 20th. And the passivity of the George Bushes of the world, and I don't hold it against him, he was raised in that milieu, it's his culture. That passivity is the 20th century, and it's over. And if we want to avoid ending up like Somalia, if we want to avoid the Middle Ages, if we want to avoid being dominated by forces that we can no longer change, we have to stop, and we have to take a role and take a responsibility in our future. And so I think the election was about that. I think journalism is increasingly about that. And I think the miracle of disability in our culture at this time, in our age, where we can actually afford the technology, is the sense that there are people who, if they take responsibility for their own future, can be living testimonies to the potential for change in their community, in their families, and in their own lives. And that's a message that needs to be understood by all in society, black, white, able-bodied, and not. And when I work as a journalist, I'm never objective, and that's the reason. And thank you very much. I think we have time for questions, right? I think there's plenty of time for questions if anyone wants to ask anything. I was with NPR for 12 years. I don't know if you heard any of the work that I did. If you want to, like, quibble about something that I did or wonder, you know, what's Nina Totenberg like or anything like that, I'm totally open to those kinds of questions. And if you want to know about ABC, that's fine. Or anything that I've just said, it's open season. Yeah, go ahead.
Can you describe the atmosphere of the Iran funeral for the Ayatollah, and was your life threatened? Actually, Iran was one of the safest places I ever went. I've been there three times now. I went once in 1989, and I went twice since. And the first time I went to Iran was for the Khomeini's funeral, which was in June of 1989. And you have to understand that when the hostages were taken in Iran, I wasn't in journalism. I was kind of a hippie music student out in Oregon. But I understood enough about... for me, it always bothered me that, first of all, the hostages were taken because I thought it was terrible. But also the fact that, I mean, you know, the Iranians weren't just taking hostages and killing them. I mean, the Iranians really had a beef with the United States. And, you know, it was easy to look at the Ayatollah and go, here's a maniac. Here's a Halloween costume if I ever saw one. You know, it's really easy to do that. But what it was not easy to discover was... what could these people possibly have against Americans? Turns out there was a very good answer to that. And so as Iran was a place that always fascinated me and always was a place that I wanted to go to and always was a place that I was absolutely convinced Americans, you know, were not going to be safe. I arrive in Iran on the day of Khomeini's funeral, and I actually had spent a lot of time just because it was of an interest of mine, learning about, you know, the kinds of mischief that America had done in Iran, the kinds of colonial problems that Iran had had, and the reasons. I mean, Iranians also have a kind of a sense of the dramatic, which you can see if you go to Tehran. And so this all made a little bit of sense to me, but it was all very abstract, and I wanted to see it for myself. So I go into Iran, and you drive from the airport, and all over Iran are these, angry slogans. This was, you know, Khomeini era Iran. It's changing rapidly now that the regime has changed. But things like, we will cause America to suffer a grievous defeat, or that maniac Carter, you know, will die the death of a thousand screams. I mean, all over Iran are these kind of, you know, your dad is a caca head kind of, you know, sort of monosyllabic anger kind of thing. And the irony of Iran was that and the reason why I thought that they had a point was that, you know, if my IRS refund was late, you know, I mean, you try to get the government to respond to you. You call them up. You say, you know, hello, I sent the check. You know, where's my refund, you know, kind of thing. And they go, sorry, we don't know who you are. And why are you calling us? And go away. And you'll get it, you know, sometime before you're dead. You know, isn't that enough? I mean, that's the basic relationship Americans have with their government. But an Iranian stands up, you know, and says something or scrawls something. It's like instant news. And a president responds to it. And Marlon Fitzwater at the White House is reacting to it. I remember Iran, 10 years after the taking of the hostages, did this stamp, you know, which you can actually buy in Iran, and it's a collector's item. And, you know, all of the correspondents, when they go to Iran, the first thing they do is they go into the Lahle Hotel and they say, you got any stamps? And they bring them out. And nobody in Iran uses these stamps. Only American journalists and American, like, diplomats go and buy these stamps about the hostage situation. It's all this kind of sick game where the Iranians made the stamp only because they knew it would drive Ronald Reagan and George Bush crazy. And indeed, it did. They printed up the stamp, and Ronald Reagan, you know, gave a news conference talking about the Iranians are crazy and they're insane. And so you get this sense in Iran that for all of their overdramatic kind of you know, self-flagellating behavior, that that they really have a good strategy for getting the government's attention. And it's something that, you know, many of us could envy in the United States, who can't get a call back on anything from the government. So you go into this environment, and I was rolling down in this crowd, and I rolled by this screaming crowd of people going, death to America, death to America, death to America, death to America. And I started recording it, you know, for a piece. And some guy comes up to the front and he says, hello, where are you from? Where are you? You know, it's American. Oh, you're from America. He's from America. And everyone stops going, death to America, death to America. And they go, you're from America, where? You know, and I say, Washington. D.C. or state? You know? And it's like, you know, most Americans, like, you know, there's a place called Tehran and it's in Iran. And like, nobody knows that there's a place called Isfahan and Izmir, you know, all these various cities, Qom, you know. Nobody knows anything about Iran. But here are these Iranians going, D.C. or state? You know? Prince George's County or Alexandria, you know, that kind of thing. And what's your zip code? And, you know, it's just, it's insane. You know, and then, how come Americans don't like Iran? How come Americans don't like Iran? I had a kind of an elaborate explanation, you know, where it was, well, there's been a big misunderstanding. But as I was standing there, as I was standing there in the sun, in the middle of this crowd of people, you know, I sort of thought, well, maybe, I'm guessing, maybe if you wouldn't scream death to America, okay, I'm just, you know, maybe if you didn't say that. And these Iranians would say, No, it's not about it. Death to America is for Bush. It's for the government. It is not for the American people are different than the government. And, you know, this is actually something you hear a lot if you go around in the third world. People think that the American government is different from the American people and that within the American people resides this spirit of goodness and freedom. And that the government are basically a kind of a bunch of redneck gas station attendants that really, really just sort of go around making problems, and that Americans are really too busy to do anything about them, and so that they kind of keep them as a necessary evil. And one of the things about the Gulf War was that this sense of the difference between the American government and the American people very much vanished in places like Iran and Turkey. But anyway, so we had this discussion and we talked about these things. And the story that I always tell about Khomeini's funeral is that this guy steps out of the crowd and says, "I'll push you." And I'm going, you know, I'm this, you know, overly independent, you know, obnoxious crip, and you know, don't push me, pal. Okay, you know, and you're an Iranian too. Okay, so don't push me. All right, and so I'm, you know, but he says, "No, I will push you. No, I must push you. I will push you." And so he pushes me, and we go to this helicopter tarmac area where basically the Iranian government was allowing the journalists to fly over the crowd to get a good view of the crowd, and also to fly out to the place where the actual burial will be, which many of you probably saw on television. If there was any danger in Iran, it was only from just being in the same place as 5 million people who are, you know, freaking out. They weren't interested in hurting anyone. There was no danger whatsoever of any kind there. But, you know, when you get 5 million people together, give them cars and, you know, things like this, you know, the crush of a crowd, you know, can be dangerous sometimes, but that was the only real danger. And we go to this to these helicopters, and of course, you know, in a typical situation in the third world, on a big story, where the whole press corps is there. You know, you've got CBS and you've got NBC and you've got ABC and you've got CNN, and I'm, you know, NPR, right? You know, and it's like, you know, I'm way in the back of the line. I mean, NPR in a wheelchair too. You know, so it's like, you know, I'm not in the front line. And these guys, these networks hire these fixers, you know, these local thugs who speak all, you know, they speak like 50 languages, and they're paid top dollar, and they've been there a week, and they've made all their deals with everyone. And it's like, we are going on, ABC is going first, you know, on the helicopter. And so I went, God, I'd really like to get on one of those helicopters, but there's just no chance in hell that I'm going to get on a helicopter. That's really clear. Well, Oscar, who's pushing me? I mean, I have Oscar, right? They have these fixers and they have these clout, and the BBC is going, "We are first. We have made an arrangement, sir. We are first," you know, and doing this whole screaming match. And I'm, you know, I'm sitting here going, "I'm not going on this helicopter. I don't know what I'm going to do. Maybe I can get somebody to take my deck on a helicopter or something. I don't know what." Oscar comes out from behind and he starts talking to this Revolutionary Guard, and he, in Persian, and I don't understand Persian, and he's just doing this,
John,
and the other guy starts crying, and they're both crying,
"I am a John, American John, please,"
you know, and I'm going, God, you know, what's going on here? I mean, I'm either going to get arrested, I'm gonna, you know, marry this guy. I don't know what the deal is. And at the end of it, the Revolutionary Guard draws his eyes and goes, "You go." And all of the press corps, you know, who like weren't paying any attention to all of this, except this some kind of like, oh, here's Hockenberry, like making a big mess again, kind of thing. And suddenly they all go, "Damn. Where can I get me one of them?" Yeah. And so I get on the helicopter and I leave the wheelchair on the ground, and the helicopter lifts off, and then it occurs to me, and it's like, I've been here in Iran about, 6 hours. I met Oscar. What was he doing? He was screaming death to America. Okay. And he's got my wheelchair. Okay, fine. And there's 5 million people, and the helicopter's lifting off, and Oscar goes into the crowd of 5 million people, and the wheelchair's black, and Oscar's dressed black, and all the women are in black. And it's like the helicopter gets about, 50 feet off the ground, and there's, Okay. Well, I hope Oscar comes back, and indeed, the thought occurred to me that, I'm in Iran, and, within 6 hours, I've managed to give my wheelchair to a local, and, we haven't even, the funeral hasn't even started yet, and I've already given my wheelchair away. I was worried, but, you can't be worried. When you're in a situation like that, you really can't be too terribly worried. So the helicopter takes off. It's an amazing sight. You really get a sense from the air of this devout sense of passage between these Shiite Muslims and Khomeini, who, for all of his problems, and lots of people said that Khomeini was, a jerk. A lot of people described Khomeini in the same way that they would describe Ronald Reagan. It's kind of like, he forgets many things, but he's important for us. This sense that he wasn't a real serious leader, but we love him, come on, he's the Ayatollah, come on, we love him, that sort of thing. And that was the basic Iranians' relationship, but they were happy that he was over because they wanted things to change. And you saw this praying, this 5 million people over the city of Tehran. It's this beautiful sight. It really affected you to see that many people would do that together. And, in America, you could see that many people for the Super Bowl or something like that, but you wouldn't see it for something like this. And then we come down, we land on the tarmac, and Oscar, I'm kind of looking around, and Oscar comes out of the crowd. Hello, Mr. John, how are you? And he comes running up with a chair, and he sees my face, and he goes, You are worried. And I said, no, Oscar, I was just, you can't, it is no problem. We are a religious country in Iran, Fine, and it was great, and we had a good time, and I said goodbye to him, and I went to the funeral and all of this, and there was the hysteria with the body falling out, and I got back to the hotel, and I was explaining to a guy who speaks very good English in Iran, who worked at the hotel. I was explaining what happened. I come back, and I'm going, I don't know. I couldn't imagine anyone stealing someone's wheelchair. And the guy looks at me and says, John, it is not New York. This is Tehran. We are a religious country. And he essentially said, and I sort of paraphrase it because it's really the meat of what he said. He basically said, if you can't trust someone on the day of Khomeini's funeral who you've met for 10 minutes with your wheelchair, John, who can you trust? And that's basically the lesson, about Iran. And it's the lesson I certainly wouldn't have learned if I hadn't had the wheelchair. It's a place that I love very much. And I think it would be great if Iran opened up, because a lot of people... It's a really wonderful part of the Middle East, and I wasn't threatened at all. I felt I had no, there was no danger whatsoever. I can give a shorter answer to another question if you like. Yeah.
Well, I want to follow up on Iran. It feels to me as though it might not be such a safe place to be a woman. What do you think?
It's not unsafe. I think, this is a kind of a thing where, there's a lot of, I think, oversimplification of the Islamic rules of practice insofar as women are concerned. There's no question that in Iran, governmental authorities exploit Islamic rules of conduct to keep men in power, in the same way that men exploit rules of Christian conduct to maintain a patriarchal system in various institutions, whether it be the corporation or the church or wherever. However, the basic sense of male-female relationships in an Islamic country and in a place like Iran has much more freedom associated with it than you might expect. One thing that, and you may have heard this if you investigate this subject at all, and it's a very complicated subject, and I don't have a definitive answer for you, but women in Iran who have spent time in the West say, I get so sick when I walk down a street in Chicago or New York of men giving me this look, the sort of, eyes in a minute, let me just get everything else kind of look. And in Iran, you don't get that. And the dress really keeps this kind of overt sexual exploitation in check, and that women actually have a much richer, more equal, it's separate from men, but a kind of a very self-confident life in their own communities. And in fact, women's organizations in the Palestinian community, in Iran, in Jordan, are much stronger on some level than the men's organizations. And that's definitely a function of the separation, the sequestering that goes on. But, you know, there's no easy answer to that. But I think it's wrong to say that Islam is primitive because of its male-female practice. I think that there is actually a way of making the rules of Islam consistent with 21st century political equality, and that there are communities in the Middle East that are working on that. But in every country, the peak of the political elite, if it's male and aristocratic, you know, is the most repressive example. And I think that's certainly the case in Iran. It's very much a political debate. It's very much a political debate. And there are many stories to tell about how it's changing. Other questions?
What observations, yeah, John, do you have about the differences in the acceptance or treatment of disability in different parts of the world?
It's very interesting. In the third world, and this relates to this kind of sense that we have about passivity, activism, I went to the third world thinking that, well, you know, there's not going to be any ramps and there's not going to be any bathrooms, so it's going to be tough. And, you know, there's something to that. However, what you have in the third world is a community that has as its assumptions, unlike in the United States, a sense that physical reality is not cooperative. It's not cooperative to the disabled. It's not cooperative, you know, to the president. I mean, it's not cooperative to anyone. So out of that arises a kind of community-wide spirit of improvisation. You know, the bus stops in the middle of rush hour in, you know, the center square of Cairo. Now, in the United States, if this would happen, everyone in the Mercedes would get out and they would, like, begin screaming, and they'd be on cellular phones going, well, you know, it's disgusting, this stupid idiot here, his bus stopped and he's ruining my day. And you'd get this sense of conflict immediately. In Cairo, if a bus stops in the middle of rush hour, everyone gets out of their car and they, like, pick up the bus and move it. I mean, they practically, that's practically what happens. Or they push it or something like this. Similarly, if you roll too near a stairway in a place like Jordan or Gaza or Iran even, you know, people go, well, we'll take you up, you know, and suddenly there's like six people. I mean, so you have to actually be careful. You can't pause next to a stairway in a place in the third world. You always look like be up there. And I would always, you know, and things that I went, you know, I could never bring myself to ask for a lot of real formidable physical help and assistance in places that required stairs in the United States, because the answer you typically get is, I mean, say on the streets of New York, hi, could you help me up, you know, these stairs? And the basic response in New York is, are you lost? Oh, it's terrible. It's awful. I'm sorry. We're paying taxes, the law, we passed the law, didn't we? You know, it's this kind of sense of, you know, it's not my problem, but we're working on it. You know, just wait here. Can't you go somewhere else? You know, that kind of thing. And that's this basic sense in America that the problem's going to be solved. We're working on it out here, you know, in the cosmos next to the Big Dipper. You know, we're not working on it today. We're not like working on it to get you in. We're not working on it, so, you know, I mean, take, for example, if you have to go to the bathroom, it's like, hi, I have to go to the bathroom. Can you help me? Oh, God, I mean, suddenly it's this whole thing of, like, we passed the law, and we're working on it, and how come this isn't fixed kind of thing. And it's like, well, you know, I really don't know how come it isn't fixed, but let me just tell you that I have to go to the bathroom, and that's really, there's really no law that addresses that issue that I know of. I don't know, maybe there's a new law. But so, you know, this discontinuity you never find in the third world. Never. There's a much more open sense of asking for help, of like getting this, of like basically going up to the neighbors and saying, hi, you know, come here, please, you have to help, please, you know, and like the whole building empties out and everyone's sitting there and like someone sets up like a picnic and is like, you know, suddenly there's like a carnival and then there's like sort of a politician comes in and gives a speech, you know, it's just, you know, that sense is something we can really use in the United States. It's a sense that, you know, it's not all about, you know, the Americans for Less Misery Act, you know. It's not about that. It's about, what am I gonna do right now? How engaged am I in the environment right now to make change happen? If people believe that they are agents of change, then suddenly things start to change all around them. And if I believe, for instance, that I could go in a restaurant upstairs that basically all I have to do is find a couple of slobs, nice people. First they're slobs, then they're my friends when we get to the top of the stairs, for heaven's sakes. But that's something that's very hard to do in our culture because we've engendered this idea that, you know, I'm an individual and you're an individual and I'm free and you're free and, ooh, don't bump me, you know, ugh, ick, you know, cooties. And we got to get rid of that in this country because it's the community that gives us strength. It's not this, you know, these, you know, grains of sand lie on a beach. You know what I mean? Trees grow in the woods. And that's really what community and democracy is all about. And to that extent, it was a real revelation, a real acquiring of wisdom to spend a lot of time overseas and to realize that the way people treat their disabled says a lot about their culture as a whole. And it gives a lot of indications of what it is those cultures need to work on. And they need really to work on the ramps over there, I'm telling you. But we need to work on some things too. Anything else? I think one more I think we probably have time for. Anything else? Well, it's great to be here. Thank you very much. I'll be kicking around, I guess, for the next couple of days. And watch the show. Next February. It doesn't have a name yet. Thank you very much.